So, as we already learned, it's not a simple thing. It is pretty complex. Complex in the sense, there's an interplay of not just one or two factors. There are a lot of factors. Even the patient will be coming with the not just chest pain, dyspnea on exertion, the breathlessness. In fact, they will be also having those mortality and associated morbidity problems as well. And as we all know, what happens is most of the times there's worsening of those symptoms. Once the patient is going to have those problems, there's going to be worsening with the passage of time. And as I already said it, when we try to see on the basis of time, in fact, the mortality is definitely going to increase. And when we are going to think about the quality of life, because this is what we all are bothered about, is it tends to worsen, in fact, with time. And that is why there are a lot of terms which are used for the description of heart failure. For example, an acute heart failure. So, for example, if someone is having a short episode, which does need hospitalization or even admission to the hospital as well. Similarly, there is also called as chronic heart failure. Chronic heart failure, what happens is there's plenty of those acute episodes and which may be stable, worsening, or even sometimes decompensated as well. Similarly, the other term which we commonly use is called as heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, and the other one is with reduced ejection fraction. So it is like completely like the English one. So where there is systolic dysfunction is the one with reduced ejection fraction. So the ejection fraction, which is the pumping capacity of the heart, gets reduced. However, the other entity with preserved ejection fraction, the ejection fraction will be more than 50%. And in fact, if we will try to see the ejection fraction, even on the echocardiography or other imaging modalities as well, it is going to be almost normal. So one of the common things which we all are worried about is, what about the clinical symptoms? So clinical symptoms wise, it is divided into four classes. Class one means there's hardly any symptoms, in fact, okay, which can be attributed to any heart disease. However, class two is the one in which there's slight limitation of the physical activity. Slight limitation means it is associated with mild symptoms. Then comes the class three. So where there is moderate symptoms. Moderate symptoms means there is marked limitation of the physical activities, in fact, and other than ordinary activities. So for example, if someone is made to walk for a little distance, they're going to have those problems. Similarly, the class 4. Class 4 is the one where there is severe symptoms. Severe symptoms means even if someone is lying down on the bed as well, they're going to be symptomatic. So coming to the pathophysiology. Pathophysiology-wise, that's why we said it is a complex disease. Why it is a complex disease is there's not just damage to the cardiac myocytes and also the extracellular matrix. Also, there's adaptive mechanism kicks into play in the form of systemic neurohormonal overreaction as well. That is the one which starts leading to fibrosis, vasoconstriction, or the hypertrophy, in fact. And that is the one which is going to be present, if possible, for a longer time. It is going to lead to the maladaptive remodeling. Okay, so that is when the heart will start to swell up or start becoming bigger, or the dilatation is going to happen. And as a chronic maladaptation, as I said it, it is going to retain the salt and also water as well. And that's how the problems is going to start to happen. So as I already said, there is also neuronal overactivation as well. In terms of, you can talk it in terms of the mechanism-wise, sympathetic nervous system, in fact, the RAS system, which is there in the kidneys, in fact, and also the natriuretic peptide as well. So these are the various parameters which tends to get affected. So being human scientists, we all always have had a urge to try to understand what is the problem, what is it leading to. So that's why there are a lot of clinical trials as well, which has already been done for the reduced ejection fraction. So way back in 1990s, one of the earliest one was SOLVE trial, in which they try to see the ACE inhibitors, how are they trying to do with these kind of patients. Similarly, they try to read about the beta blockers like the bisoprolol, the ARBs as well. And one of the last valuable trials which came in 2014 was called as the PARADIGM heart failure study. PARADIGM heart failure study. So what they tried to do was, they tried to study a special molecule, which is RNA versus enalapril. A lot of people tend to ask, why enalapril actually? So what had happened is, If you will be going abroad, especially in the most of the academic centers or the in the Western world as well, most of the centers, they tend to use this called as enalapril, in fact. Okay, so that is why they were it was compared to the standard treatment or the standard drug. So this is what we already understand it. So what happens is this unique combination, which consists of sacubitril and valsartan, so it tends to simultaneously inhibit on two areas. One is the NEP and also the AT1 receptors, in fact. So that is the reason it is not just a single mechanism. So it is more of a dual mechanism and also tends to affect on an ultimate basis, also affects the remodeling, in fact, as well. And that is the reason we start seeing a lot of those positive clinical evidences, which has already been shown by various clinical trials, as I said it, the paradigm heart failure. So these are some of the earlier trials, as I already said it about the solved T trial, which was seen using the ACE inhibitors, in fact. And the paradigm heart failure study, as I already said, so this is literally the first study which tried to test the unique molecule, which is called as the LCZ696. One of the main reasons why we try to give ANA medicine is not just for treating the signs and symptoms of the patient, but also try to really benefit the patient. And how are we going to benefit those patients is by giving them a better quality of life and also decrease the death rate as well. And those are the factors which is called as the morbidity and also mortality benefits, in fact. So that is why when this therapy was used, so especially about the efficacy, there was, of course, a lot of primary outcome benefits in terms of, for example, 20% reduction was seen in the cardiovascular deaths, for example, when those patients were taken with ARNI inhibitors compared to the enalapril. Similarly, the cardiovascular reason, which was leading to hospitalization as well, it decreased up to 21%, in fact. So when we talk about the secondary outcomes as well, there was a bigger difference in terms of not just it reduced the symptoms and the physical limitations which was caused by the disease. In fact, when we try to compare the renal function as well, it didn't affect or didn't worsen it, actually. Because a lot of times what we happens is whenever we are trying to use the ACE inhibitor and all, if someone is already having a pre-existing renal condition, we need to be really, really extra careful for that. So there are a lot of other parameters as which we should be careful, as we are seeing on the slides about. It just not only caused the readmission rate was lower, but also the mortality and morbidity benefits were lower as well. In fact, one of the other worst things which we all are worried about is called as the sudden cardiac death. The heart failure patients are always at a higher risk for the sudden cardiac death as well. And in fact, if you look carefully over here, it also tend to reduce the sudden cardiac death rate as well. Even when we try to see for the overall life expectancy of the patient and also the heart failure disease-free survival, those patients are doing much better when we try to compare with the enalapril as well. So what were the unique things which was associated with this study? So this was indeed one of the largest mortality morbidity trial of patients with reduced ejection fraction. And in fact, what had happened is, yes, this is the one which showed there is benefit of these kind of patients, not just in middle-aged, the old age, but also all the different ages of population where heart failure medications can be used. So that is one of the reasons this medicine was, for the first time, especially in this field, it was given an accelerated indication. And it was indicated, given a class level 1 level of evidence. And it was recommended and it was included, in fact. It was included not just in the European Society of Cardiology, but also American Heart Failure or the ACC guidelines as well. However, we all should also be taking care of what are the limitations of this unique molecule as well. So if someone is hypersensitive to any of its components, we should not try to give. Similarly, if someone has had history of angioedema, otherwise, if someone is already using ACE inhibitors, so what we should try to do is, we should try to give an interval of around 36 hours. So During which we should not give anything else, and after that we can of course start the RNA, or this molecule in fact. Similarly, we should try to avoid usage with alliscarinine or otherwise also with the ACE or ARBs as well. At the same time, we should not try to combine this group of drugs. So this is the ESC 2016 guidelines, as we can already see. So how the other drugs should initially be started. So they say it like this: if there is a patient with reduced ejection fraction, you should try to initially start with ACE inhibitors and beta blockers. Of course, you should try up titrate them to the maximum tolerable dose. And even after that, the ejection fraction is less than 35%, still symptomatic, that is the time when you can think of starting them on this drugs, in fact. So one of the other important things is not just starting off the right medicine, but also the up titration as well is very, very important in the sense. So there should be a recommended titration as well to achieve the best results. Why is, for example, as I already said, for example, if someone is already on ACE inhibitors, wait for 36 hours, okay? And then you start always with the minimum dose if someone is having lower blood pressure. However, if someone is having a well-tolerable dose, blood pressure like 140 or 150, okay, you can start with a good dosage. And after, for example, you have started with 50 milligrams BD, you can go to 100 milligrams, then further, even up to 200 milligrams. But as I said, it keep on estimating those other parameters as well. The renal parameters, are they symptomatic, or is there any other contraindication, or if they are developing some other problems as well, like angioedema or something.